question we frequently get from customers inquiring about building or using our process analyzers for inline analysis and real-time analysis is where to start with building those inline analysis calibrations. And there's a couple different ways to do that, but we often suggest that they start with a benchtop calibration and then transfer that over for use on the process system. So Bruker has over 1,000 benchtop calibrations ready to use that we can often transfer for use in inline applications. So that's a good starting place. But another place to start is you could just build the benchtop calibration, because it's easier oftentimes to build those out and then transfer that calibration over. So then the question becomes, well, what does the transfer look like? And really, it's just a matter of collecting data from your inline system. So we take a probe, we put it in a process, so in a pipe, in a reaction vessel, and then at that point, collect data, collect spectra, collect samples, and then add that process data to the benchtop calibration. And then once that's modified, we can then apply that and use those modified calibrations for real-time predictions in line. And so today we're going to talk about what that looks like. So in this case, on the bench, I have set up our process analyzer, which is the Matrix F2, and it's connected to an immersion transmission probe. So in this case, we have a 1 millimeter path length transmission probe connected by 1 meter fiber optic cables. We'll talk a little bit more detail later on some of the things to look out for when you do these types of transfers. And I've already prepared 6 samples. An actual transferring of these models, you probably want to do more like 20 samples. But for the purpose of the video, we're going to do 6. So I've prepared those 6 samples. We've scanned them with the process analyzer, and I have the reference data for that. So now we are going to build this calibration and show you what that looks like. So I am now in Opus, and I'm going to start up our Quant software, Quant 2. I'm going to load my existing benchtop calibration, which in this case is for apparent proof analysis of 190 proof ethanol, so in a distillation process. And so we have that calibration, and I'm going to add the spectra from the 6 samples that I prepared earlier today. So I'm just going to go and find where I have those stored. So there's my spectra, and I have all of the reference data. I'm going to paste that in there. I'm going to make all of these samples a different color so we can see where they show up. So benchtop calibration, process spectra added in there, plus the reference spectra. My first step, I'm just going to go to my validate tab and click validate, which is going to build the calibration with the process spectra included. And if I click on my color tab here, I can now see the 6 spectra spread throughout the range of our calibration. So this is a pretty tight range of a calibration. So the original calibration goes from roughly a little over 189 proof to roughly 190.6 proof. So the range on the calibration is very small, and we've actually extended that by roughly half a point with these additional spectra in here. And you can see it spans the range, and it's pretty close. Now, we can make this a little bit better. So with Quant 2, we have the optimize feature, and the optimize feature allows you to look at different spectral ranges, different pre-processing techniques, and then it's going to display sorted by the error and the number of factors in the calibration. You get to choose which one you think is going to work best for you. So now it's done with the optimization. It sorts the algorithms by the rank, or by the error and the rank. So the rank being the number of factors, then it tells us what regions it's using and what type of preprocessing. So there are different ways to look at this. I think I kind of like this region here. The more of the first overtone and the second overtone region. So I'm going to use those parameters, build another calibration again, including those factors. And now we can see that our blue dots, which are process spectra, are much tighter to the best fit line, or the one-to-one line. And we just want to make sure that we're not overfitting this. So make sure that your number of factors is appropriate. Make sure your error versus rank plot is appropriate. Essentially, we're dealing with a two-factor system. So there's water and there's ethanol, and there's not a whole lot else in there. So you really should not have a large number of factors in this model. If you did have that, that would tell me that we're running the risk of overfitting this model. So we want to avoid that as much as possible. So the next steps from here would be to save this, apply that in your CMET scenario, if you have your system set up in process, and start collecting data, grab some samples, and run those for reference chemistry to validate that model. And that's really all it takes. You just need to grab some samples, add them to a benchtop calibration that already exists, and then start that validation process where you grab another handful of samples to see how well it's predicting. Thanks for tuning in to today's video about transferring calibrations from a benchtop system to a process system. If this is something you're interested in learning more about, please go to our website or check out the links below, and appreciate your time. Thank you.